Well, can I bid you a very warm welcome again to our service of Sunday worship. Our theme for today is True Freedom, and a little later, Mark Smallwood, who's our youth minister, will be preaching to us from Romans chapter 8. You'll probably realise by now that we're a benefice of seven congregations spread across seven parishes. But there's an eighth congregation that meets alongside us week by week. Westcote Methodist Chapel can be found in the village of Nether Westcote, which is just a stone's throw from St Mary's Parish Church in Church Westcote. We enjoy very cordial relationships with the parishioners of Westcote Methodist Chapel. We work together quite frequently in joint services and other events. So it's a particular joy this morning to be broadcasting this service with our Methodist friends from Westcote Methodist Chapel. The senior steward at Westcote Methodist is Tony Gibson.
Thank you, Stephen. It's a privilege for me to take part in this service, and I'm delighted that we can broadcast it from the chapel. The chapel was built in 1852. We've no idea what it cost to build, but the strip of land it was built on cost £3. There are two of us living in the parish today who have ancestors amongst the original trustees. Interestingly, a group of Protestant dissenters petitioned the Bishop of Gloucester in July 1800 to meet in the Malt House for worship. They may have been the first group of Methodists in Nether Westcote. It wasn't, though, the first connection of Methodism with Westcote. John and Charles Wesley both visited Reverend William Morgan, curate in charge of the parish church, with whom they were friendly. John's brief visit was noted in his journal on the 4th of October, 1739, and Charles preached in Westcote Parish Church in March of 1740. This was just a couple of years after their deep spiritual experience. I love the words of John Wesley. When reading Luther's preface to the Book of Romans, he said, "I felt my heart strangely warmed. I felt I did trust in Christ, Christ alone for salvation. And an assurance was given me that he had taken away my sins, even mine, and saved me from the law of sin and death." During my years in this little chapel, I have seen many people's hearts strangely warmed, coming to faith in Christ and knowing the assurance of forgiveness. Our opening greeting: grace, mercy and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Our first hymn is one of our favourite Charles Wesley hymns, "And Can It Be?"
Thank you.
come together in the name of Christ to offer our praise and thanksgiving, to hear and receive God's holy word, to pray for the needs of the world, and to ask the forgiveness of our sins, that by the power of the Holy Spirit we may give ourselves to the service of God. But first we reflect on our failings, for we have too often exchanged the worship of the living God for idols of our own imagining. So as we gather to offer our praises to the holy and undivided Trinity and to worship him in spirit and in truth, let us call to mind our sins. We'll pray together the prayer that will appear on the screen. Lord our God, in our sin we have avoided your call. Our love for you is like a morning cloud, like the dew that goes away early. Have mercy on us, deliver us from judgment, bind up our wounds, and revive us. In Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. May Almighty God, who sent his Son into the world to save sinners, bring us his pardon and his peace, now and forever. Amen. Blessed is the Lord, for he has heard the voice of our prayer. Therefore shall our hearts dance for joy, and in our song we will praise our God. Holy God, faithful and unchanging, enlarge our minds with the knowledge of your truth, and draw us more deeply into the mystery of your love, that we may truly worship you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. We're very much looking forward to hearing Mark Smallwood preach to us shortly after our two readings. And the first of those readings is brought to us by John Bentley, who's one of the Methodist congregation. It's a combination reading from the books of Ezekiel and from Jeremiah. After John's reading, we'll join together in Matt Redman's hymn, Bless the Lord, O My Soul.
The first reading is taken from Ezekiel chapter 36, starting at verse 22, and then continuing with Jeremiah chapter 31 from verse 31. Ezekiel chapter 36. Therefore say to the house of Israel, this is what the sovereign Lord says. It is not for your sake, O house of Israel, that I am going to do these things, but for the sake of my holy name, which you have profaned among the nations where you have gone. I will show the holiness of my great name, which has been profaned among the nations, the name you have profaned among them. Then the nations will know that I am the Lord, declares the sovereign Lord, when I show myself holy through you before their eyes. For I will take you out of the nations, I will gather you from all the countries and bring you back into your own land. I will sprinkle clean water on you, and you will be clean. I will cleanse you from all your impurities and from all your idols. I will give you a new heart and put a new spirit in you. I will remove from you your heart of stone and give you a heart of flesh. And I will put my spirit in you and move you to follow my decrees and be careful to keep my laws. And now from Jeremiah chapter 31. The time is coming, declares the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah. It will not be like the covenant I made with their forefathers when I took them by the hand to lead them out of Egypt, because they broke my covenant, though I was a husband to them, declares the Lord. This is the covenant I will make with the house of Israel after that time, declares the Lord. I will put my law in their minds and write it on their hearts. I will be their God, and they will be my people. No longer will a man teach his neighbour or a man his brother, saying, Know the Lord, because they will all know me, from the least of them to the greatest, declares the Lord. For I will forgive their wickedness and will remember their sins no more. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
I'm not afraid to die.
second reading is taken from Paul's letter to the Romans, chapter 8. Therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, because through Christ Jesus, the law of the Spirit of life set me free from the law of sin and death. For what the law was powerless to do, in that it was weakened by the sinful nature, God did by sending his own Son, in the likeness of sinful man, to be a sin offering. And so he condemned sin in sinful man, in order that the righteous requirements of the law might be fully met in us, who do not live according to the sinful nature, but according to the Spirit. Those who live according to the sinful nature have their minds set on what that nature desires, but those who live in accordance with the Spirit have their minds set on what the Spirit desires. The mind of sinful man is death, but the mind controlled by the Spirit is life and peace. The sinful mind is hostile to God. It does not submit to God's law, nor can it do so. Those controlled by the sinful nature cannot please God. You, however, are controlled not by the sinful nature, but by the Spirit, if the Spirit of God lives in you. And if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, he does not belong to Christ. But if Christ is in you, your body is dead because of sin, yet your spirit is alive because of righteousness. And if the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead is living in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his Spirit who lives in you. Therefore, brothers, we have an obligation, but it is not to the sinful nature to live according to it. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
I wish I knew how it would feel to be free, sang Nina Simone. I want to break free, sang Freddie Mercury. Freedom, yelled Braveheart. Freedom is indeed a glorious thing, and we all want it. But what is freedom? And how do we get it? Well, let's start by thinking about what freedom is not. David Wood was born on April 7th, 1976, in the United States. He grew up to be a troubled young man who got in lots of trouble with the law. He recalls one particular life-changing moment when he was on the run from the police and he came to a property with a beautiful garden. Now, he could either run around the garden or he could run right over it. In that moment, he decided that he didn't care about what he viewed as society's silly moral rules. He didn't care about the people who owned that garden, and so he trampled right over it. And in that moment, he described feeling a rush of freedom. We'll come back to David Wood later. Last week, Helkius explained Romans 7, verses 14 to 26 to us. He explained how we're not free in ourselves. We're not free to keep God's moral law. As Paul says, I'm a prisoner of sin. The apostle sets up an inner conflict. In my inner being, I delight in God's law, but I see another law at work in the members of my body, waging war against the law of my mind and making me a prisoner of the law of sin at work within my members. There are two ways out of this conflict. One is to allow the sinful nature to have the victory. It promises a kind of instant freedom, a rush. We've all tasted it, the rush of doing what we're not supposed to do. Perhaps for some of us, the rush of sexual immorality, looking at things we shouldn't look at, doing things we shouldn't do with our bodies. For others, perhaps it's the rush of boldly telling lies and getting away with it, And for others, perhaps the rush of gossiping behind people's backs. Well, David Wood had his taste of freedom, and he wanted more. The only way to really be free, he decided, was to keep breaking the moral law. In fact, the more serious the law, the greater the freedom that would come from breaking it. And so he started to build bombs. In fact, he went to study chemistry at university so he could be a bomb maker. But even that wasn't enough. You see, the way he saw it, anybody could kill people who were you didn't know. But if you really wanted to break the rules, then you would kill people close to you, your own family perhaps. So at the age of 18, shockingly, he attempted to take the life of his own father. This freedom to do bad, this freedom to break the rules, is a false kind of freedom, because it's a freedom which leads to condemnation. It's a freedom which leads only to death. For David Wood, he was sentenced to 10 years in jail for malicious wounding. But the Apostle Paul says that a sentence hangs over all of us for our crimes, for our sins against God's moral law. It's the sentence of death. Romans 6:22 says, "For the wages of sin is death, and we have all sinned." But the good news is that there is a true freedom available to us in Jesus Christ, and it's this which the Word of God proclaims to us today through Romans 8:1 to 11. It is the freedom from condemnation through Christ's death, and the freedom from the power of sin through the indwelling Holy Spirit. Paul proclaims that we have been set free from the penalty of sin. The penalty of sin is death, and Paul describes this as condemnation in verse 1. We now are free from condemnation. But how and why? Simply because Christ has died the death that our sins deserve. The wages of sin has been dealt out, not to us, but to Christ. And so when Jesus Christ died upon the cross, he received the condemnation for our sins. This is what Paul means when he says in verse 3, God, sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful man to be a sin offering, condemned sin in sinful man. But Paul also proclaims that Christ's righteousness has become our own. That is, Christ's perfect obedience to his Father is credited to our account. This is what he means when he says, in order that the righteous requirements of the law might be fully met in us. How could the righteous requirements of the law be fully met in us if it's based on our behaviour? And so we can illustrate these two things, our freedom from condemnation and the gift of righteousness, in the following way. Imagine that God the judge has before him two books. One is a record of our sinful life, my sinful life. Every evil thought, every self-centered ambition, every wrong action of my life is written in this book. This is the book of Mark Smallwood. Another is the record of Jesus' perfect life. It records all of his God-glorifying deeds and words and thoughts. It records his perfect obedience even to the point of death on a cross. God takes our book and in his mercy writes Jesus' name upon it. Jesus takes responsibility for our sins and he bears the consequences for it on the cross, and so he dies. But he then takes Jesus' book and writes our name upon it. If we get the credit for his righteous life and we receive the consequences, eternal life. And this eternal life is not some ghostly existence beyond the grave, but a relationship with God that begins now, today, and continues forever after our physical resurrection from the dead. This is what Paul says in verse 11. If the spirit of him who raised Jesus from the grave is living in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his spirit who lives in you. But Paul doesn't stop there. He proclaims a freedom from the power of sin. Verse 8 says, those controlled by the sinful nature cannot please God. You, however, are not controlled by the sinful nature, but by the Spirit. The Holy Spirit sets us free to start to keep God's moral law. The Holy Spirit sets us free to love our neighbour as ourselves and to love the Lord our God with all our heart, mind and strength. And this is the freedom which David Wood came to see was true freedom. During his imprisonment, Wood came to see that the freedom he'd chased had led him to only pain and sorrow. And so in 1996, at the age of 30, he prayed in these words, God, I don't know if I'm going to believe in you tomorrow, but I believe in you right now. If you can do anything with me, you're welcome to it. If you can do anything with me, you're welcome to it. And he describes what happens next like this. When I sat up from that prayer, the entire world looked different. Like the entire world was a different colour. For the first time in a lot of years, I didn't want to hurt anyone. God changed David Wood's heart. He is now a husband and a father. He was reconciled to his own family, to his dad. And he's a missionary to Muslims, the head of Act 17 Apologetics. In fact, some of you may have heard of Nabil Qureshi, the famous Christian apologist, the author of the book Seeking Allah and Finding Jesus. Well, Nabil was converted through the loving friendship and witness of David Wood. This is the same David Wood who had tried to kill his own father. Now, that kind of transformation is what I call a miracle. Reflecting on his search for freedom, Wood said this, for years, I was ready to sacrifice everything for a kind of freedom, a freedom from external control. It is a false freedom because we just end up using it to degrade and destroy ourselves, tarnishing the image of God so that we won't be reminded of what we are and of what responsibilities we share. True freedom is found in not having this inclination and desire to turn against our Creator. That's true freedom. And this is a freedom which God alone can give us. As it says in verse 2, through Christ Jesus, the law of the Spirit of life set me free. And in verse 9, you are not controlled by the sinful nature if the Spirit of God lives in you. It is a freedom which God promised long ago through his holy prophets, as we heard in our Old Testament readings. I will give you a new heart and put a new spirit in you. I will remove from you your heart of stone and give you a heart of flesh. And I will put my spirit in you and move you to follow my decrees and be careful to keep my laws. It's a freedom which is now available to us through faith in Jesus Christ. If God has performed this miracle within us, if, as it says in verse 9, the Spirit of God lives in you, then it will produce a change in our lives. And this starts with the way we think. So Paul describes this in verse 5. Those who live in accordance with the Spirit have their mind set on what the Spirit desires. A better translation would be, those who live in accordance with the Spirit have their mind set on the things of the Spirit. The things of the Spirit. We can understand what this phrase means by looking at how Paul uses it in 1 Corinthians 2, 12-14. There he equates things of the Spirit with spiritual truths. And by spiritual truths, he refers to truths about what he calls the things which God has freely given us. And so the person indwelt by the Spirit of God, the person who we might describe as born again, will have a mindset that is focused on the gospel. It's like this. Percy Sledge famously sang, when a man loves a woman, can't keep his mind on nothing else. And it's true. He'll daydream about his beloved. He has her on the brain. He'll think about her, the way she talks, the way she walks. Likewise, if a man has been born again, he starts to love God. And he can't help but think about him. He'll think about God's wonderful grace. He will gratefully ponder God's kindness to him. How God chose him and loved him before the creation of the world. How Jesus has saved him, not because of his good works, but because of his mercy. How the Father has given him his Spirit and promised him a resurrection. How God daily guides and provides for him. Thank God he's given us brilliant examples of this spiritual mindset in the New Testament letters. Look, for example, at Paul's flood of thanksgiving and praise in Ephesians 1, or Peter's in 1 Peter chapter 1. Of course, often we don't have this kind of mindset. Our minds are focused on worrying about work or money or relationships. Brothers and sisters, let this be an encouragement to us to keep our minds fixed on the things of God. Let us gratefully meditate on God's works and ways. As the psalmist says, "Praise the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits." Allowing the Spirit to thus control our mind will result in life and peace, as Paul says in verse 6. And as we do this, we will find ourselves empowered to live in obedience to God. But Paul contrasts the person who lives in accordance with the Spirit to the person who lives in accordance with the sinful nature. This is the person who has not been born again, who has no love for God, and so doesn't have God on the brain. As it says in Psalm 10, verse 4, in all his thoughts there's no room for God. Try to talk to this kind of person about God and he'll change the subject. Such a person's mind is hostile to God. Verse 7. Friends, this calls for self-examination. How often do we think about God? How often do we talk about Jesus? Do we think about pleasing him? If the answer to all these questions is never, or hardly ever, then perhaps you do not have the Spirit of God living in you, which is to say that you are probably not a Christian. And that, I'm afraid to say, is bad news. It means that you are not free from condemnation and that you are not free from the power of sin. But the good news is that if you call on the name of Jesus, if you pray to him to set you free, then you will be free indeed. And there'll be an opportunity to do that shortly. To sum up, there is a false freedom, which is the freedom to break God's moral law. This results in death and guilt. But there is a true freedom available to us in Christ. This is freedom from the penalty of sin and from the power of sin. If we have been set free, this will change the way we think and act, and we're called to cooperate in this. Let us pray. Firstly, a prayer for those of us who have not yet tasted this freedom. Lord, thank you that you died to set me free. Please forgive my sins. Please give me a new heart and put your Spirit within me so that I might live to please you and be confident of eternal life. Amen. And now a prayer for those of us who know that we are in Christ Jesus. Thank you, God, Father, for your mercy. Thank you that you have given us true freedom in your Son, Jesus Christ. Thank you that he took the penalty that we deserve. Forgive us where our minds have been set on other things, on the things of this world, and we've had little space in our hearts for you. Please keep us walking in the Spirit and meditating upon the things of the Spirit. For the honour of your name. Amen. If you have prayed, asking Jesus to set you free for the first time, then please do be in touch with us through the website. And now we're going to sing a hymn, It's by City of Light and it's called Yet Not I, But Christ in Me.
What gift of grace is Jesus my Redeemer? There is no more for heaven now to give. He is my joy, my righteousness and freedom, my steadfast love, my deep and boundless peace. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus, for my life is wholly bound to His. Oh, how strange and divine, I can see
Let us declare our faith in God using the words on the screen. We believe in God the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth is named. We believe in God the Son, who lives in our hearts through faith and fills us with his love. We believe in God the Holy Spirit, who strengthens us with power from on high. We believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Tony will now lead our prayers of intercession.
We begin with a collect special prayer for the day. Merciful God, you have prepared for those who love you such good things as pass our understanding. Pour into our hearts such love toward you, that we, loving you in all things and above all things, may obtain your promises, which exceed all that we can desire. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And the morning collect. Almighty and everlasting God, we thank you that you have brought us safely to the beginning of this day. Keep us from falling into sin or running into danger. Order us in all our doings and guide us to do always what is righteous in your sight. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Dear Lord, whose purposes of love embrace the whole world, send peace upon the earth, that nations may no longer prepare for war, and that they may try not to destroy, but to understand each other. Take away all bitterness and hatred, and grant that people of all colours and races may learn to live in fellowship together. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, we bring to you the many throughout the world who have lost loved ones during the COVID crisis. May they know your love and presence with them. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, would you also give wisdom to governments, our own and worldwide, as they grapple with many difficult decisions. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And a moment's silence as we bring our own personal prayers to the Lord. And we join together in the family prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Just one or two notices. As you'll have already heard if you were watching 2 weeks ago, we're now open in our parish churches on the second and the fourth Sundays of the month, but we're continuing to stream services on the first and the third. And we'll carry on with this practice for the next month or two and then review our decisions. Our online provision of all that you'll need continues, and can I particularly once again commend our daily readings. These, as you know, will be published every single week. They're emailed out on a Friday to those who are on our mailing list, but you can also pick them up online direct from the website. If you're not on our mailing list and would like to join it, please email us through the website, and the address of both our website and Westcote Methodist website will be showing on your screen now. The Methodist Chapel provisionally reopens on Sunday, August the 9th, but again, you might want to check that website for confirmation. You'll notice as you attend our resumed services that things are just a little different because of health and safety precautions. Please do take note of the notices and instructions that you'll receive when you come to church, particularly with regard to using hand gel and keeping a safe distance from worshippers who are not part of your household. Everything should be laid out clearly for you when you arrive at church. Our next stream service, therefore, now is August the 2nd, Sunday, August the 2nd. Thank you for joining us. We very much hope that you will join us at that service as well. Our final hymn is a great resounding classic, Blessed Assurance, Jesus is Mine. Our final blessing. So now may the love of the Lord Jesus draw you to himself, the power of the Lord Jesus strengthen you in his service, and the joy of the Lord Jesus fill your heart, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and with those whom you love, today and for always. Amen.